on the day after a new moon. Yesterday's new moon was in the, it was a midday new moon. The new moon is never visible because it's lined up with the sun. And what happens at the new moon every month is the beginning of a new astrological cycle. Astrology is cycles within cycles within cycles. Our calendar month always begins on the first day of the month. But astrologically, there's a cycle that begins once a month, whatever time of month it appears, which is the new moon, and that was yesterday, and we're just separating from it, meaning that we're stepping into a Leo time of a year because the sun and the moon lined up in fiery, expressive, outgoing Leo yesterday, and that's an important statement unto itself.
Well, for several reasons. As Rick pointed out, we have a new moon every month, and the new moon begins a new monthly cycle of about 28 days. And this one in Leo is a new moon in a sign of creativity or expressiveness. Leo represents that phase of the cycle within the zodiac when we sort of step outside the family. We move beyond the protection of the sign Cancer to express ourselves in the light of day in the sign Leo. And we know that there are various expressions of Leo. If we're innocent and childlike, it's creative, warm, loving, and generous. But if we're damaged egos, then we tend to be bombastic and attention demanding in a way that's driven by insecurity rather than discovery. So one of the things to work on, I think, with any new moon, but particularly a new moon in a fire sign, is this notion that life is new and it's here to be discovered and created. If you're willing to play and don't take yourself too seriously and don't look back to the wounds of the past, this is a wonderful, warm wave that can take you on a romantic, playful, and pleasant ride. But if you're settling scores from the past, or can't let go of what Daddy and Mommy did or didn't do, then the ego inflates itself in a way which is painful to experience, whether it's yours or whether you're just watching somebody else's wounded show.
And although Leo is playful and fun-loving, and there's the when the summer sun is out, like it is today. Today is summer. The flowers are out. There's the sense of the garden is expressing itself in full beauty. However, this particular lineup of the sun and the moon at about 14 degrees of the sign of Leo is different than many Leo new moons because... Wow. And for an encore, is different than many Leo new moons because of its connection to the sudden electrical, lightning-like, explosive planet of Uranus, who just showed his weirdo, unexpected self. This energy distinguishes this full moon from perhaps other Leo full moons.
New moons.
New moons. I said full moon. I meant new moon. Thank you.
Yeah, and what's interesting is that Uranus is a planet of freedom, and it's in Aries, a fire sign. That's why it aligns harmoniously with the sun and moon in Leo. And that underscores the potential for innovation and for creativity that's present here. But I think there's something else that we need to do to tap into it, and that's not care about how other people respond or react to these creative impulses. And there are several reasons. One, a new moon is the joining of the sun and the moon. It's an awareness of the self, and it needs to be rooted in that sense of oneness. Secondly, Uranus is a weird, strange, out-of-the-box planet in independent Aries. And if we're going to tap into, I think, the innovation that this offers, it certainly suggests that we don't ask other people what they think of our creative ideas when we're just in the beginning stages of it. Leo is about daring. It's about daring to express ourselves, and it's not like we're totally insensitive to others, but a little insensitivity probably helps. And the thing that put me on to this is, this new moon is square, we're at a right angle with the moon's nodes. And the nodes of the moon, where the orbits of the Earth around the Sun and the moon around the Earth connect with one another, are where we connect with one another. And the square to the nodes suggests that it's not going to be that easy to integrate this new me, this proud me, this expressive me. And I think if we try too hard, then we kill some of the joy, some of the innocence, and some of the imagination that this new moon offers.
Yeah, Jeff, it reminds me of the Nobel Prize winner Richard Feynman, who was known to say and actually titled one of his short autobiographies, "What You Think of Me Is None of My Business." There's that sense of when you're a fire and you are burning, your goal is to, in the moment, create as much energy of the raw materials that you have in that moment. Now, Leo, as a fire sign, wants to sustain that growth like the sun that's going to last, you know, millions or, you know, hundreds of millions of years. But Aries doesn't want to sustain anything. It wants to, like lightning, even Uranus lightning in Aries, even if it only lasts a second, that's plenty long enough, it's got to go. So there's this whole sense, I think, that what you were saying about not necessarily slowing down enough to care what other people think when you're in that flow of creativity or brilliance or genius. And that would be great if it was the only planet up there, but we have this other thing that may be more important even than the new moon, because in astrology, the faster moving the planet, the less long the aspect lasts, and ultimately the less weight it may have. It's not 100%, but it's a good rule of thumb. So when you get alignments or geometric patterns, aspects formed by slower moving planets like the Uranus-Pluto that we've been talking about and will continue to, it holds the pattern for years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, that has weight. Well, today, this afternoon, we had an exact hookup, an opposition between two heavy weights, and this will, I think, in some way, not only overshadow the new moon, but it makes us have to deal with the consequences of our creativity.
Yeah, I agree. It's an extraordinary contrast with the new moon in Leo trine Uranus, which is, I'm a kid, I just want to play, I'm just exploring, leave me alone, or participate, but don't tell me what to do. But Jupiter, which is called guru or teacher in Sanskrit or Hindi, has a certain moralistic side. It's about truth, not about spontaneous discovery. And Pluto, the manipulative lord of the underworld, opposite Jupiter, suggests that there's this attitude that if your beliefs aren't right, you're going to hell.
Beliefs, Jupiter, hell, Pluto.
So, right. So we have on the belief, teacher, philosophical, higher mind level of things, which is the domain of Jupiter, something that's pretty demanding and punishing and requires accountability, because Pluto will collect the taxes. Pluto will hold us accountable one way or another. And that's really in contrast, again, with this new moon. So I agree with Rick that even though we've got this wave of creativity, it's happening against the bigger, deeper background story, which is quite serious.
Well, yeah, and I assume that many of you heard the rumblings that were running around the internet about a week and a half ago about July 29th being this grand sextile and this magic, and it'll be the most enlightened and transformative moment ever. And what was going on that day is significant to now for a very important reason. And it's not about that grand sextile. So here's, back on the 29th, give or take a day, we had the moon in earthy Taurus making a harmonious triangle to Pluto in earthy Capricorn and Venus in earthy Virgo. And we were just coming off of this other grand trine, which is a longer pattern that held its weight, Saturn, Neptune, and Jupiter and Mars. And we've been talking about this. We talked about this last month and the month before. But there was all this talk on the internet about the importance of this event. And I'm one of those who said, there's never a bad time to have good thoughts. And if you want to sit down and meditate on this cosmic moment with cosmic thoughts, great, go for it. But the moon only holds this position for a couple of hours. It's not a big deal. Astrologically, no one's going to remember, or very few people will remember, what they actually meditated on this particular moment that was making so many people go crazy with excitement. However, there was something going on within those couple of days that's relevant today. And what was going on was Mars, at 9, 10, 11 degrees over the days before and after, Mars was opposing Pluto, and then it squared Uranus. Now that in itself is not huge, but it's a little bit bigger, it's a little bit heavier weight, because Mars and Pluto are tough planets, and when they line up, that can be a tough energy. Now the only reason why we're having this discussion at all is that now Jupiter is holding that position where Mars was back a week and a half ago. And so there is, and this is the way astrology often works. If you can think back around the 27th, 28th, 29th, Saturday was the day it was exact, I think, but Friday, Saturday, Sunday, right in that period of time, a week and a half ago, there may have been things that you were dealing with then that may have been difficult, that now, as Jupiter is in the equation, that Jupiter, it's not that it's not difficult, it's just that Jupiter gives a sense of optimism or philosophical way in which we can move with the sum of this energy, and we're getting this resonance of this pattern that's actually holding, but Jupiter moves slowly enough that it's going to be lined up opposite this Pluto, although it's exact today, for several days, and it comes in and out of focus all the way through April of 2014. So this is a pattern that will hold. And it's not just about Jupiter and Pluto, because over the next week or so, Jupiter then will square Uranus. And remember, it's the Uranus-Pluto square that sits behind pretty much all the intense changes that are going on last year, this year, and next year.
Yeah, I talked earlier about the contrast between sort of the buoyant, happy child of the new moon in Leo versus the intensity and strong opinions and judgment of the Jupiter-Pluto opposition that Rick has just given us more information about. But part of the job of an astrologer is to take ingredients that don't look like they go together and create a coherent story.
Right.
Every one of us has in our birth chart, which is about who we are, about our personalities, we're all gonna have different kinds of contrasts. And the great work is being able to weave together these disparate elements to make some sense out of it. And what I was thinking as Rick was talking is what Jupiter-Pluto is about on another level is we have the right to mess with each other's minds and beliefs. That the boldness, the creativity, the expressiveness, the love, the courage of the new moon in Leo is not meant to just have us dance around like little children, but it is connected to the Jupiter-Pluto. It is to awaken things in others, and often what awakens things? A disturbance. Pluto is disturbing. It takes us into the little crags and crannies we'd rather not look at. And this notion, this idea that we can get benefits, that we grow as individuals and collectively by dealing with discomfort and sometimes inviting it for what it moves, is reinforced by the moon's north node, a point of growth or integration, and Saturn, a place of necessity in Scorpio.